Let's do geometric first. That comes first in the book. Geometric random variable, typically thought of as being the number of trials until the first success. Both geometric and binomial random variables are in the context of the Bernoulli trials, where in each trial you have success or failure. Like with baseball, get a hit or not. With flipping a coin, maybe getting ahead is success and getting a tail is failure. Of course, it could be the other way around, right? It depends on your perspective. In the baseball example, if you're the pitcher, it's success if the batter fails to get a hit, and failure if they do get a hit. Success and failure depends on your perspective. And yes, success has a positive connotation and failure has a negative connotation, but there are applications where both success and failure are neither positive nor negative in terms of their real life connotations. So you need to be flexible. Just realize there's just two options. The probability of success, P, is also assumed to be constant for each trial, and the trials are also independent. What happens in the past doesn't affect what's going to happen now. The fact that I flipped my coin like I did the first day of class and got 8 tails in a row doesn't affect my probability of getting tails the next time. Still 0.5. This is the number of trials until the first success. Actually, there is another way to think about geometric random variables. You could also think of it in terms of the number of failures until the first success. It's a slightly different way of thinking about it, which results in a slightly different formula. It's related. If it takes you 5 flips until you get the first head, that means you got 4 failures until you get the first, 4 tails until you get the first head. If heads is success and tails is failure. So it's related, but not exactly the same thing. It is an alternative way of thinking about geometric random variables. The PMF, again, I'm going to call it a PMF. The book will call it a PDF. We saw last time. Is P times Q to the X minus 1. P is the probability of success on any trial. Q is the probability of failure. And those are opposite events, and therefore Q equals 1 minus P. So you can also think of this as P times 1 minus P to the X minus 1. This is the formula you use for X equal to 1 or 2 or 3 or 4, etc., forever and ever. There are infinitely many values that X can take on with positive probability. Yes, on any given flip, the coin has a probability of 0.5 coming up heads. Theoretically, it could take me 1,000 flips until I get my first head, or even 1,000,000 or 1,000,000,000. Of course, the probability that it takes me 1,000,000,000 flips until my first head is so astronomically small, it's beyond your imagination, but it technically is positive. What's the CDF? Capital F of X. You could write it instead of saying all X here, since X takes on a PF, X takes on these values with positive probability, you could write it as a sum. Little x goes from 1. Okay, I should write it with the probability notation first. Probability that capital X is less than or equal to little x. It's a sum. Let me use a different letter here, like a T. T goes from 1 to little x. I want to use a different letter there because I want the x to be up there. Of little f of T. That is a sum. T goes from 1 to x of P times Q to the T minus 1. And this is called a geometric random variable because this is a geometric series. That's why it's called the geometric random variable. Remember geometric series from calc 2. If you write it out, this is p times q to the 0, which is just p, plus p times q to the 1st, plus p times q squared, plus et cetera. The last one's going to be p times q to the x minus 1, replace t with x. That's a finite geometric series with first term p. There's your first term. Common ratio, it's called q. That's what you got to multiply each term by to get the next term. And the number of terms is x of them. And therefore, by the formula for the sum of a finite geometric series, you take the first term, multiply it by 1 minus the common ratio to the x power here. I guess I'm assuming x is a whole number when I write this. A positive integer. If x were not a positive integer, I'd have to use the greatest integer in x. Forgot to mention that. Or for simplicity, let's assume x is a whole number. You do the first term times 1 minus the common ratio to the power of the number of terms over 1 minus the common ratio. If q is 1 minus p, then 1 minus q is p, and the p's divide out, and you're left with 1 minus q to the x. Or in general, even if x is not a positive integer, capital F of x is 1 minus q to the greatest integer in x, at least if x is greater than or equal to 0. Is technically 0 if x is less than 0. That's a 1 right there. The graph of this is a step function, though the steps are not equally spaced. Also notice that as x goes to infinity, q to the x goes to 0 because q is less than is between 0 and 1. At least if p is bigger than 0, then q is less than 1. This goes to 0 as x goes to infinity. Therefore, this function does go to 1 as x goes to infinity, which again will happen if q is less than 1, which is equivalent to saying p is bigger than 0. You wouldn't really do this kind of example if p were 0, though. Flip a coin and your probability of heads is 0, you wouldn't really do that. So we usually do assume p is positive and therefore q is less than 1. And I guess for most applications, p would also be less than 1 and therefore q would be positive. And because of that going to 1 as x goes to infinity, that's enough to say, yes, this is a valid probability distribution. It's enough to say that this 1 is the infinite sum of the little f of x values. If you wanted extra confirmation, you could use the formula for the sum of an infinite geometric series. In calc 2, we write it as typically a over 1 minus r, first term divided by 1 minus the common ratio. This would be p over 1 minus q, which is p over p is 1, would be another confirmation of that. Running low on time, you should make sure you understand the derivation of the various things related to geometry random variables, like the moment generating function, you should be able to follow this proof. It involves more work with geometric series. And therefore, by taking its derivatives and plugging in zero, you should be able to verify this. If x is geometric, expected value is 1 over p, and its variance is q over p squared. This first one makes good intuitive sense. If you're flipping a coin, p is 0.5, 1 over 0.5 is 2. On average, it takes 2 flips to get your first head. If you're a baseball player with a 333 average, p is 0.333. 1 over that is, well, close to 3. On average, it takes 3 at-bats to get your first hit. Anytime you start the count of at-bats again. Roll a die. What's your probability of getting a 6? It's 1/6. On average, it takes 1 over 1/6, 6 rolls to get your first 6. This makes good intuitive sense. That may be less so, but work with it. To end class today, our last 6 minutes, let's talk more about the binomial distribution. Again, I really have already talked about the binomial distribution because it was the baseball example that was the main one from last time. Number of hits in 3 at-bats. Binomial distribution, or you could say binomial random variable. We've got a certain number of trials in. For baseball example, that was 3. We got a certain probability of success on any given trial. For the baseball example, that was 0.23. Flipping a coin, it's 0.5. Fair coin. Rolling a fair die, it's 1/6. X is now not doing what we did with geometric. We're not counting the number of trials until the first success. What we're doing is we're counting the number of successes in n trials. Number of successes in n trials. The PMF, little f of little x, turns out by thinking about combinations, chapter 1, to equal n choose x. Yes, this is n choose x, the number of combinations of x objects taken from a group of n objects, times p to the x times q to the n minus x. And you use this formula for x equals 0, 1, 2 through n. Yes, including 0, not, we don't start at 1. Because you could have 0 successes. You could have 0 hits and 3 at bats. Again, this formula comes from it. What it really comes from is it comes from generalizing our baseball example from last time, where I drew the tree diagram and I multiplied the numbers along the branches, got numbers over on the right. Sometimes I added them. I was thinking about the multiplication rule for independence of events, and I was also thinking about axiom 3, the addition rule for mutually exclusive events. If you generalize that, you will get this. And for capital F of X, you just add up these values cumulatively, starting at 0. Is there a formula for capital F of X? Not really. It's just the sum of things like this. So you use this formula. You should be able to use the formula. Let me show you, you can use a calculator to do this. There's a table in the book as well that you can use, but you should feel comfortable using a calculator. By the way, next Tuesday, we're going to use technology a lot. So next Tuesday, our big first technology day with calculators, spreadsheets, and Mathematica. If, for example, you want to find the probability of getting two hits and three at-bats, if your average is 230, you can go to the distribution menu, second distribution menu. Scroll down to binomial PDF. Now, I'd call that a binomial PMF, but the calculator is like, okay, we'll call it a PDF. Number of trials, 3. Probability of success, 0.23. Number of successes, 2. What's the chance that a 230 baseball player will go for 2 for 3? It's fairly small. 0.122199. Yes, that looks familiar from Tuesday. And the CDF can be used to find cumulative probabilities as well. One thing I didn't have time for today that came up on the homework you turned in today is that computing differences of capital F values can compute certain kinds of probabilities. That came up on your homework today. It's something you should rethink about over the weekend. Make sure you're comfortable with it. We will try to emphasize that next Tuesday as well. And maybe even start chapter 4 a little bit. It's analogous to the fundamental theorem of calculus with integrals, actually. Fun. Have a good day.